Greetings and welcome to online lecture series of HVAC and R. Now we are starting unit number 4, that is ventilation and infiltration. There are 5 basic concepts in unit number 4. And these concepts we are going to cover in 4 lectures. Concept number 1 that we will cover in today's lecture, that is lecture number 1, that is indoor design criteria and thermal comfort. Concept number 2 is indoor air quality, that is also called as IAQ. In that, we will discuss the air contaminants present in the house or indoor air. Concept number 3 is outdoor design conditions and the use of weather data. Concept number 4, that is ventilation of cooling. And concept number 5 is space air distribution. So these are the 5 concepts associated with this particular topic. Mainly, this particular topic is associated with air conditioning part, and we are covering this unit in 4 online lectures. Ventilation and infiltration, there is a basic difference between a ventilation air and infiltration air. You might have studied in air conditioning part in B, that is what is meant by ventilation load and infiltration load. Ventilation load, that is the air of the that is load of fresh air which is coming from outside, which is generally a filtrated air, and that is the load on the air conditioner. So to bring the temperature and humidity down to the comfort level, so some load is required, or some cooling load is required for the equipment. So that is ventilation load. Infiltration load, that is air coming from outside to inside room, that is through various sources like the opening and closing of the doors, then cracks, and the air which comes associated with the people coming from outside occupant, because this is infiltrated air, that is not coming from the filtration or through proper air conditioning system. It is come directly into the room from outside. So there is a separate load of ventilation load and air infiltration load, both coming from the outside air. But ventilation load, that is purposely introduced into the system to provide a comfort condition, and infiltration load, that is unavoidable load that is coming from these sources. So we are mainly focusing on the aspects associated with this ventilation and infiltration. Today's lecture, we are going to cover the indoor design criteria and thermal comfort. We mainly discuss the basic parameters to be controlled to maintain the thermal comfort as per the indoor design criteria, and the thermal and comfort chart, factors affecting the thermal comfort and the comfort chart, comfort and discomfort, comfort and discomfort. These contents we are going to discuss in today's lecture. Indoor design conditions are mainly categorized in 3 groups, that is basic design parameters. Basic design parameters, that is indoor air temperature, air velocity or movement, relative humidity, the purity of the air is also there. So these are the factors which generally monitored in the basic design parameters or to maintain the comfort condition. Air contaminants is the another design, another group where we mainly control the contaminants of the air, and accordingly the how to control these contaminants, that also we will focus on. And the specific design parameters, especially the noise level, that mainly arises because of the diffuser sections, because when the air conditioner air comes inside through various supply outlets, there is a possibility of noise, or even the air which is moving from conditioner, that is from the air handling unit AHU to condition room through ducts. So while transporting that conditioner air through duct, there is a possibility of noise. And that parameter also need to be considered. And the pressure difference between space and surrounding, generally, there is a possibility of positive pressure as well as negative pressure. Then atmospheric pressure is maintained in the conditioning room, depending upon the requirement. positive pressure is generally maintained in the surgical room, where there is a possibility of the, that any contaminant should not come from outside. So that's why positive pressure is created. So whatever the contamination is there, that it will go out, not come inside the room or inside the operation theater. Some places the negative pressure is also maintained. But obviously, the in order to maintain the positive pressure difference, it requires a lot of more quantity of air. So that is always at the cost of more ventilated air. So these are the conditions maintained, and mainly it is divided into these three groups. Thermal comfort, because comfort air conditioning systems, the main part is the thermal comfort of the human body. Human body is feeling comfort when its body temperature is around 30 to 35 degrees Celsius, especially I'm talking about the skin temperature. At the deep level, the body temperature is 37 degrees Celsius. But at the skin level, the body temperature to be maintained at around 30 to 35 degrees Celsius, depending upon the person's physics or person's other parameter. But in order to maintain this body or skin temperature or body temperature, the proper heat balance should happen. That is, whatever the heat is produced in the body, it should be equal to the heat lost by the body. Then and then the body maintains skin temperature. So there are various heat sources. The major heat source is metabolism, where due to metabolic heat, the heat is produced inside the body, that is due to chemical reaction. Then the heat is coming into the body due to convection, radiation, conduction, and also through shivering. So these are the various sources of heat produced inside the body. The major source is metabolism. And this heat has to be dissipated out. And the media of dissipated again is the conduction, convection, and radiation. At the same time, the heat is evaporated out. That is, the heat is also lost by evaporation, that is through sweating glands. So this heat balance equation is very much essential for stable comfort condition of any human being. So this is about the thermal comfort. Metabolic heat is mainly associated with the person's ability. The people have different metabolic rates that can fluctuate due to activity level and environmental conditions. The ASHRAE 55, which is ASHRAE 55 standard, as per this standard in 2010, it defines metabolic rate as a level of transformation of chemical energy into heat and mechanical work by metabolic activities within an entity. So this is a level of transformation of chemical energy. So chemical energy is converted into heat and the mechanical work. And that is depending upon the metabolic activities within a human body or any living entity. Usually expressed, this metabolic heat is usually expressed in terms of unit area of the total body surface. And the metabolic rate is expressed in met units, which are defined as follows. So 1 met, that is equal to 58.2 watt per meter square. So it depends on the surface area of the body. So 1 met is equivalent to 58.2 watt per meter square, which is equal to the energy produced per unit surface area of an average person seated at rest. So 1 met, that is the average person when it is seated at rest, it produces energy that is at a rate of 58.2 watt per meter square of the body surface. The surface area of an average person is generally 1.8 meter square, that is equivalent to 19 feet square. So ASHRAE standard 55 provides a table of met rates. In the standards, the table is given depending upon the person's age, person's weight, person's gender. We can pick the values of met rates, and from that we can calculate the source heat. For varieties, it also depends on the varieties of activities. Some common values are 0.7 met for sleeping conditions. So there's some activities also given there. So 0.7 bit is the lowest one. That is when the person is sleeping, then it this produces less lowest heat. That is 0.7 bit. 1 bit for a seated and a quiet position. 1.224 bit for a lightweight activities, especially a standing position. 2 bit or more for activities that involve movement, walking, lifting heavy loads, or operating machinery. So up to 2 met the metabolic rate can increase. That is again per meter square. For intermediate activity, the standard states that that it is permissible to use a time weighted average metabolic rate. If individuals are performing activities that vary over a period of 1 hour or less, so these are the values are generally vary for the period of 1 hour or less. If for a longer period, different metabolic rates must be considered. So these are the values specified. That is, especially if the activity is for 1 hour or less than that, then we consider these values. If for a longer period, we have to go for other. So other tables are also there for different metabolic rates. So this way, this is because this is the biggest source of heat. So we have to take these values from the ASHRAE table, especially while designing the comfort air conditioning system. So metabolic rate, this is a distribution, almost 60% metabolic rate, that is for resting metabolic rate. When the resting metabolic rate is the rate when the person is at rest, it dissipates almost 60% of the total. Then 30% contribution of the physical activities, and only 8% that is a thermic effect of feeding, that is during a digestion process also some metabolic heat is generated. So that is around 8%. So this is a distribution of 100% metabolic rate. It mainly defines metabolic rate. It is the amount of heat that must be released from the human body. So whatever the heat is generated, that must be released. So 58.16 watt per meter square is generally is a conversion factor of 1 met. 1 met generally value we consider when the person is at rest. This is actually a resting metabolic rate. So resting metabolic rate in calories around so general fit person, it dissipate 14 or it burns around 1400 calories per day. For a man, woman, they burns around 1600 to 1900 calories per day. So metabolic rate also depends on your high other parameters also, like height, weight, and age. Suppose, for example, these are the three men, the man one, man two, and man three, having same weight, around 180 pounds or 82 kg, same age of 50 kg, but the height is different. So obviously, the person having more height, that is man one, it produces more heat, that is 17-19 calories per day, followed by man two, whose height is less than the man one, and followed by man three. So as per the height also, as height increases, metabolic rate also increases because of more surface area it provides. It also depends on the age factor also, weight factor also. So as the weight increases also for the same particular height, as the weight increases, metabolic rate increases. Age factor. So for the same particular height, as the age increases, metabolic rate decreases. And also from gender point of view also, for the same particular height, it also decreases with the gender as well. Women metabolic rate is comparatively less than the men. So this is a basal metabolic rate formula. So with the help of this formula, we can estimate the metabolic rate as per the person's various parameters, geometric parameter, as well as age factors or other parameters. So this way we can calculate. Now, in order to maintain a thermal comfort conditions of the occupants in the air conditioned space, there are six factors that are mainly affects or the influence of the thermal comfort of the human human being or any occupants, living beings. So out of six parameters, four are external parameters. These are common for all occupants, and two are the specific parameters. They are mainly varies with the person, with their clothing as well as their metabolic rate. So first parameter, that is air temperature. So it mainly associated with the sensible and heat and evaporation loss, because in order to heat loss from the occupants, generally these six parameters affect the thermal comfort of the human body. So air temperature, so the air temperature mainly is the drivable temperature, or the temperature which is maintained in the room. So the air temperature is the average, it is the average temperature of the air surrounding the occupant. With respect to location and time, according to ASHRAE 55 standards, the spatial average takes into account the ankle, waist and head levels. So at the different levels, the air temperature also varies. That is called a spatial average air temperature, which varies for seated or standing occupants as well. The temporal average is based on 3 minutes. It is actually a local time base, based on 3 minutes interval with at least 18 equal space points in time. So average air temperature is obtained. There are two categories, spatial average temperature and temporal average air temperature. And it mainly associated with the, because this air temperature, it absorbs sensible heat as well as latent heat from the human being. And this way, while deciding the average air temperature, it is actually a drivable temperature of the air. So as per the ASHRAE standard, there is a proper procedure for obtaining the average air temperature of the room. So this is an elaborative explanation of average air temperature of the surrounding to the occupant. And as per the ASHRAE standard 55, it has mainly two components, spatial average air temperature and temporal average air temperature. Spatial average temperature, it takes into account the ankle, waist and head levels, which may varies from seated or standing occupants. So standing occupants, it is different, and that seated occupant is also different. The temporal average, it is again depend on the time base. So every 3 minute interval, at least 18 equally space points, this particular temperature. So by taking this readings, the average air temperature is decided. The second important parameter, that is radiant temperature. So radiant temperature is also helps contribute in removing sensible heat exchange, or not only removing, it mainly extends the sensible heat, not latent heat is not there. So radiant temperature is related to the amount of radiant heat transport from the surface of the human body. And it depends on the material's ability to absorb or emit the heat. Its body, skin, how much it emits, also the surface, what is the clothing is there, depending upon that also its rate is different. Emissivity of that the cloth material, and the mean radiant temperature depends on the temperatures and emissivity of the surrounding surfaces as well as the view factor, or the amount of surface that is seen by the object. So a lot of parameters involved in radiant temperature, so it varies. So while considering the radiant temperature, these parameters are considered, but it mainly contributes in dissipating the sensible heat of the human body. So this is second parameter, that is radiant temperature. So third parameter is the air velocity. Air velocity is required for, because it increases the rate of heat transfer, therefore sensible heat exchange as well as the rate of evaporation also varies. So in HVAC, air speed is defined as the rate of air movement at a particular point without regard to direction. So direction is not important. According to again ASHRAE standard 55, it is the average speed of air to which the body is exposed with respect to location and time. Similar to air temperature, it has also two components, spatial component and the temporal component. temporal average is the same as the air temperature, while the spatial average is based on assumptions that the body is exposed to a uniform airspeed. According to the set set thermophysical model, according to the assumptions are made. However, some spaces might provide strongly non-uniform air velocity fields and the consequent skin heat losses that cannot be considered uniform. Therefore, the designer shall decide the proper averaging, especially including air speeds incident on unclothed body part that have a greatly cooling effect and potential for local discomfort. So these are the factors need to be considered. So the uniform velocity to be considered where. So generally, non-uniform velocity fields are there depending upon your body surface. So especially the body surface clothes are covered with the cloth, which experiences less airspeed than that have a uncovered surface. So the care is to be taken. It should not cause any discomfort for the uncovered part of the body. So the local discomfort can take place. These are the factors must be considered while deciding the air velocity. This is the third factor. Fourth important factor that is or parameter is the humidity factor. So humidity part is mainly associated with the evaporation losses. Higher the humidity, less is the evaporation, and vice versa. Sweating is an effective heat loss mechanism in the humidity case, because the evaporation loss is mainly because of sweating that relies on evaporation from the skin. However, at higher or relative humidity, the air has close to a maximum water vapor that it can hold. So evaporation and therefore heat loss is decreased. So at higher relative humidity, heat loss is very less. On the other hand, a very dry environment like RH, if it is less than 20 to 30%, are also uncomfortable because of their effect of mucous membranes, because that mainly the dryness of the skins taking place if the relative humidity is very low. The recommended level of indoor humidity is in the range of 30 to 60% in air conditioned building. So this is the range need to be maintained, because if very high relative humidity, if it is greater than 60%, the evaporation losses or the heat dissipation due to evaporation is not proper. So again, it gives the discomfort for the human being. And for a very low RH, that is less than 20 to 30%, it also causes uncomfortable position to the human being because of the dryness of the skin. So mainly it maintains the range around 30 to 60%. But new ASHRAE standards such as the adaptive model allow lower and higher humidities depending upon the other factors involved in the thermal comfort. So continuously there change is going on in the thermal comfort chart. So the new norms are also coming up, which can accommodate slightly less than 30% or slightly greater than 60% as well. So span or the range is increased nowadays in the new ASHRAE standards. So this is the fourth factor. So these four are the external factors which mainly taken care by a conditioning system or mainly of the wall structure of the building. Means air temperature, air velocity and humidity mainly controlled by the air conditioning system. And the radiant temperature, it is mainly depending upon the surface area of the room. Remaining two factors, these are the specific factors, and they vary from occupants category also, and also their clothing styles. So the fifth factor is metabolic rate. So metabolic rate is mainly, again, whatever the heat is produced by the due to metabolic heat, then it has to be dissipated, and other dissipation is through sensible as well as evaporation rate losses. So This metabolic rate, it mainly varies with the person's habit also. So food and drink habits may have an influence on metabolic rate, which indirectly influences the thermal preferences. These effects may change depending on food and drink intake. Body shape is another factor that affects the thermal comfort. Heat dissipation again depends on the body surface that we have discussed in previous slide. So it varies with the surface area as well. A tall and skinny person has a larger surface to volume ratio and can dissipate more heat easily as compared to the and it that person can tolerate higher temperatures also than the person having a rounded body shape. Means the fatty person, the comfort level is slightly at a lower temperature. Suppose if a tall and skinny person feels comfortable at suppose 25 degrees Celsius, maybe fatty person won't comfort doesn't make fatty person will not feel comfortable in that particular temperature, maybe slightly a lower temperature, because the dissipation rate of tall and skinny person is comparatively greater, so it can sustain a comparatively higher the room temperature, but not a rounded body shape person like fatty person. So metabolic rate depends on the shape of the or the fattiness of the human body also. So depending upon your categories, generally this particular factor is taken into account, because again this is depending upon the person's physics, its eating habits also taken into account. The last factor, that is clothing and insulation. Actually, clothing and insulation, it acts as a resistance to heat transfer. So it prevents the sensible heat loss. And there is one, depending upon the clothing, generally the resistance is considered. So one clo is equivalent to 0.155 meter square per kilowatt. So this is the inverse of rate of heat transfer. So per meter square. So that inverse of rate of heat transfer is the resistance. So this is a resistance. The heavy clothing generally have more resistance. Light clothing having a less resistance. So the amount of thermal insulation worn by a person has a substantial impact on thermal comfort, because it influences the heat loss and consequently the thermal balance. Layers of insulating clothing prevent heat loss and can either help keep a person warm or lead to overheating maybe. Generally, the thicker the garment is, the greater insulating ability it has. So depending upon the clothing and depending upon the person's, because suppose there is a combination of fatty person, aged person, then young persons, and gender differences are there. So actually the temperature is maintained to suit suit everyone. Suppose, for example, if there are a person having a lightweight person having a tall and slim person, it feels shivering when the temperature is low. In that case, they can wear the clothing. With the help of clothing, they can make the comfort conditions. So clothing, because generally the comfort condition is maintained to suit everyone. So that particular, depending upon the persons also, it varies. So few people feels comfortable at 25 degrees Celsius, few people feels comfortable at 22 degrees Celsius. So again, depending upon its metabolic rate and clothing style. So accordingly, the clothing and insulation also take a part. So these are the six factors which generally takes into account while designing a comfort air conditioning system. Out of six factors, three are taken care by air conditioning system. Radiant temperature is mainly taken care by the building structure, location, orientation of the building, depending upon that radiant temperature. And the two factors, they're mainly taken care by the occupants. These are specific factors. So depending upon the type of occupants, the metabolic heat also varies, rate also varies. So their clothing style also matters. So these are the six factors which need to be considered while designing thermal comfort conditions, especially temperature and humidity conditions in air conditioning space. The ASHRAE comfort chart is mainly designed for this. Again, ASHRAE comfort chart is designed as per the ASHRAE 55 standards, which is related with the thermal environmental conditions for human occupancy. It is an American national standard published by ASHRAE, ASHRAE 55. Generally, for thermal comfort, this standard is used extensively. That ranges of indoor environmental conditions to achieve acceptable thermal comfort for the occupants of the building. Humans generally feel comfortable between temperatures of 22 degrees Celsius to 27 degrees Celsius. This is a variation of, again, depending upon the metabolic rate, this variation is there. And the relative humidity of 40 to 60%. The comfort chart is an empirically determined effective temperature index. So while drawing the comfort chart, effective temperature is determined, and altogether it defines effective temperature index that has been published by ASHRAE since 1950. So first ASHRAE chart is developed in 1950, and the latest chart, it was new ASHRAE chart, but still it was developed in 1965. The purpose of this comfort chart is to indicate the percentage of people feeling comfortable at various effective temperatures, which is called as operating temperatures in winter and summer. And accordingly, while designing an indoor air conditioning, this ASHRAE comfort chart is taken into account. The comfort zone is defined as a range of climatic conditions within which the majority of persons would feel a thermal comfort. This is actually the range that is the comfort zone. So we'll see, this is a ASHRAE comfort chart. This is a new ASHRAE comfort chart, which is also called as a comfort discomfort chart. A short note can be asked on this. So the previous slide information, this slide information is sufficient for writing the short note. So this chart is developed by taking operating temperature on x-axis. Operating temperature, which is also called as the effective temperature, which takes into account the drivable temperature, solar temperature or solar radiation, convective heat transport from the building, material or wall material. So all these are taken into account in operative temperature. So operative temperature is taken on x-axis and dew point temperature on y-axis. Now, this comfort chart is developed based on the activity level of 1.2 MET. So a slight activity we can consider here, because person sitting at rest, dissipates or it generates heat at a rate of 1 MET, which is equal to 58.3 watt per meter square. But while developing this ASHRAE comfort chart, the activity level is considered, the light activity level is considered. So that is around 1.2 MET. Then for boundaries of summer, this is you can see there are two comfort zones, summer comfort zone and winter comfort zone. And the in between there is a year round. So the overlap zone that is applicable for year round air conditioning system. So first of all, we'll discuss the comfort zone boundaries of summer air conditioning. So there are four boundaries. Side boundaries, then bottom boundaries and upper boundary. So as far as the effective temperature is concerned, for side boundaries, effective temperature or operating temperature. So side boundaries, the effective temperature is 22.5 degrees Celsius to 26 degrees Celsius. So these are the two side boundaries for summer air conditioning or summer comfort zone. Then the upper boundary is 20 degrees Celsius wet bulb temperature. So this is upper boundary of 20 degrees Celsius wet bulb temperature. And the lower boundary That is a DPT around 2.2 degrees Celsius. So this is 2.2 degrees Celsius. So 0 to 5 scale, in between this is 2. So 2 degrees Celsius, 2.2 degrees Celsius. So this is a comfort chart or comfort zone for summer conditions or summer season. So this is a zone in which almost 90% feel comfortable. So while designing air conditioning system for summer, we have to pick the conditions. So your indoor condition point must fall in this particular zone, where the clothing insulation, because summer generally the people wear the light clothes. So the clothing insulation is considered around 0.6 clo. So 0.6 multiplied by 0.15. So less insulation is provided. So this is about the summer comfort zone. So boundaries for winter comfort zone are now, as far as the effective temperature is concerned. So this is 20 degrees Celsius to 23 degrees Celsius. That is 23.8 degrees Celsius. So these are the side boundaries. Then upper boundaries, 18 degrees Celsius WBT, slightly lower WBT is required for during winter season. And at the bottom, boundary remains common. That is same as summer, that is 2.2 degrees Celsius. Here the clothing insulation is slightly more because some heavy clothing is required or wear. Generally people wear heavy clothing or heavy garment in winter conditions. So the clothing factor is 0.9 clo, and that is multiplied by 0.155 square value. So this is a winter comfort zone. Means while designing a winter air conditioning system, your indoor condition points must fall in this particular zone. If you have to design an air conditioning system which will last for entire year, so that is called as year around air conditioning system, your operating point or indoor condition must fall in this particular zone. So while taking a indoor air design conditions or indoor conditions, generally the comfort charts or comfort zones are used. It also varies from place to place also. So there are actually, as per the ASHRAE standard, there are 5 different zones they have developed. And for these all 5 zones, 5 comfort charts are developed. And depending upon the zone, the comfort chart is utilized. So generally, if you come across the ASHRAE design projects, we need to comply with this ASHRAE standards. And as per the ASHRAE standards, we have to follow these norms, especially for thermal comfort. We have to follow all the norms given in ASHRAE standard 55. So like that also here we have to follow. So this is a ASHRAE comfort chart. We can say a new ASHRAE comfort chart. And how this chart is developed, what are the summers, comfort zone and winter comfort zone that we can discuss. So with this, we have finished this particular topic where we have considered only two important concepts, that is the factors affecting thermal comfort. We have discussed 6 factors affecting thermal comfort. Out of that, 4 are external factors and 5 are specific factors depending upon the occupant's style of working, their physique and other parameters. Their explanation, import, or each parameter's clear definition you should be able to explain at the end of this particular topic. Also, you should be able to explain the ASHRAE comfort chart, there how that chart is developed, what are the important features of ASHRAE comfort chart, and when it is used, ASHRAE comfort chart. So at the end of this particular topic, you should be able to explain this or discuss these concepts in depth. Next lecture, we will focus on indoor air quality, that is IAQ. On Genomia Moodle, I have also given a link of that indoor air quality, that is the course of Coursera. So definitely it's hardly a 4 hours course. You go for that course, definitely you will come to know the latest trends of the indoor air quality. So next lecture we will focus on that. I hope this lecture is clear to you. Thank you very much.